When a young family moves into an old house, they soon discover they are not alone. Late night attacks by violent spirits turn their lives into a living hell. Until a courageous young boy challenges the dead who refuse to die.
There's no time.
O'clock.
All right, it's episode 94.
Yeah, and we're back on a haunting episode. These are fun to do.
Yeah, we figured we hadn't done one in a while.
Yeah.
And so we had to go back through our DVD collection and find one that was kind of one that stuck out to us.
Yeah, this is one of my favorite episodes, actually, because there's certain elements in this story that kind of remind me of what happened to me when I was a kid.
It is very poltergeist-like.
Yeah, this one's got Billy Bean in it. And I actually talked to Billy Bean once online, and I'll get to it when we get there.
But yeah, this is a pretty entertaining. This is, yeah. Like I said, this is one of our favorite ones from season two. It's called House of the Dead, and so we'll get into that a little bit and discuss the case behind it and all that.
Yeah, and we're back on that sunrises and sunsets. I got a tequila sunrise.
Sunrise, sunset.
And Jenny's got a rum sunset.
Yeah.
I've been going off into tequila lately.
Yeah, what's your problem?
I don't know.
Just kidding.
Went down to Sam's and I bought one of the Member's Mark silver tequila. Man, that stuff was good. It's just like Patron.
And it comes in a very nice bottle.
Very nice bottle and everything.
Yeah. For how much was it? Like 13, 14 bucks?
No, it was a little bit more than that. It was almost 20 for a huge bottle.
Yeah, but it was bigger than that.
Yeah, huge bottle of it.
Yeah, it's a pretty big bottle. It's a good deal, though.
Yeah, if you guys like tequila, go get some of that Member's Mark silver tequila. And if you like Patron, it's real close.
Yeah, and I think I mentioned this before. It's like, I like tequila sunrises, but really I can only drink one.
Man, I like it.
And then I kind of get sick of the taste. But,
I like that agave flavor, man.
I went back to rum.
Makes me all Mesoamerican when I drink this shit.
You're all Mesoamerican. And you're like the whitest motherfucker ever.
Going straight honky on it.
Yeah, you are. It's like uber honky.
Yeah.
All right, so let's do a couple of shout-outs. If you didn't see our latest movie review, it was a double feature. Blackula and Scream, Blackula Scream.
Yeah, and I got to tell a New Orleans story about Larry the Pimp.
About Larry the Pimp.
Yeah, about
Larry the Pimp. Pimp and later Larry the Bank Robber.
Yeah, Larry the Bank Robber. Then later, Larry the Jailbird.
Yeah, so that was pretty entertaining. Go check that out if you haven't already. Also, be sure to check out our Zazzle store at zazzle.com/13o'clock, and we have shirts and a tote bag sale. Remember to check out our Patreon page and our blog if you'd like to support the show. I'd also like to send a shout out to Sheena for her generous PayPal donation. Thank you very much, Sheena.
Yep, thank you very much.
And also, we have a new patron who is named Weapons and Stuff 93.
Oh, awesome. Weapons and Stuff. Me and him probably hang out.
I know. That's what I was thinking. I'm like, that sounds like your kind of guy.
Yeah, I should probably subscribe. Let's see if he's got any good videos.
Yeah, you probably should.
Yeah.
So yeah, that's our newest patron. So thank you very much, you guys. Also, I just recently recorded an interview with a podcast called Parallax Views. I think it's a new podcast because they don't really have that many episodes. I'm not sure if it's up yet
of
this recording.
Yeah, we don't know how many subscriptions they have.
But as soon as it's up, I'll put a link in the description of the show, whichever one comes out when it goes up. Also, should we tease the movie?
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay, so
yeah, we're gonna be in a movie.
I have been asked, and Tom is going to be in it too. I have been asked to have a small role in a. It's sort of not. It's not really a horror movie. I don't think it's kind of like a supernatural horror romance musical.
We haven't seen the script
type thing.
We haven't seen the script.
We're getting the script in a couple of days. Yeah.
It's a full length film.
Yeah, and I have two scenes in it, and you have a scene in it.
Yeah, I got.
I also get to sing in it.
Yeah, we have to go to the studio. And she's got to
record a song. So the day after this show comes out, Wednesday, I'm going to be in the studio singing.
Yeah, I don't know if I mentioned anything about it on the last show, but I did the NPR show.
Yeah, a few days ago we went.
And recorded I got the rest photos. I got a couple photos of me in the studio and all the endo wafting around every there wafting around. Those guys like to smoke. I'll tell you what, man. But that's just the way those studios are.
That is. The weediest smelling.
It's the weediest smelling. Well, they record rap music there.
Pretty much. Too, you know? Yeah, I saw that seems like the main. Albums. Yeah. They have done other ones as well. It looks like they did some kind of 90s alternative Creed type rock, but it seems like.
They smoke too.
It seems like mostly hip hop. But yeah, it's like the whole, the weed has seeped into the very atmosphere of the walls.
I was expecting Bob Marley to come around a corner any
I think I'd be more amazed if Bob Marley came around the corner.
Or Snoop Dogg.
Because he'd be like zombie Bob Marley or ghost Snoop, Bob Marley.
Snoop Dogg come around the corner.
Yeah, it definitely did seem like that was going to happen any second. But yeah, so I have to go there.
It's cool though.
I have to go there on Wednesday and record a song. So we'll see how that goes. And also, I believe that...
The leads are two of our friends, actually.
Yeah. Yeah, we know everybody that's going to be
We know everybody, yeah. He's a local... filmmaker guy. He's made films before.
Yeah.
But they were documentaries. Now that he's retired, he wants to actually make movies.
Yeah.
He's part of the local scene and he's probably in his 50s, wouldn't you say?
He's 64.
64. He's in pretty good shape. He's an old goth.
Yeah.
Actually.
Yeah. Or old punk, really.
Yeah, old punk rocker. He was in a punk rock band, I think, at one time.
He was in Naked Ray Gun for a time.
Okay. All right. Well, we're going to see what he's going to do. We'll see what we can do.
It sounds like fun. I mean,
it sounds like it, yeah.
And I haven't got to sing in a long time, so we'll see how that turns out.
We don't care. We're just going to go ahead and contribute to the local scene, you know.
Yeah, we'll see how. I'm sure it'll be fun. It'll be a fun experience.
That's our local filmmaker, so we'll be in it.
All right. So other than that, let's get to our news story. This is just a really brief news story. It doesn't have anything to do with paranormal necessarily, but this was just something that amused the shit out of me. You know how in Pompeii, you know, they found all those bodies that were preserved from the ash from the eruption of Vesuvius 2,000 years ago.
Yeah, Susie sang a song about it called Cities and Dust.
That's exactly what that song is about. There you go. But yeah, so a lot of it's been excavated, but evidently they're still doing, you know, various excavations around the place. And one of the most recent things that they found, this is like the saddest thing ever. And I'm going to show you the picture in a second.
Okay.
So you can react to it. So they found a skeleton. It wasn't like preserved like the other ones, like the ash and everything like that. This was a skeleton and his head had been crushed by this giant rock. So what happened to this poor bastard 2,000 years ago was that he escaped from the eruption of Vesuvius and got out of the town, kind of, and then a huge rock fell on his head and crushed him to death.
Where'd the rock come from?
They think that it was maybe like a stone that was over a door or something like that.
Okay.
And it just kind of fell on and squished his head.
What would a stone be doing over a door?
Supposedly, the archaeologists are saying it's a door jam.
Okay. All right.
I'm going to show you the picture right now.
Okay. Damn. That's a hell of a door jam.
It is, yeah.
And you know what's funny is that he's actually a skeleton. He's not like the other bodies.
That's what I just said.
He didn't get that the pyroclastic flow on him.
Right.
And they know that's
what I mean. That's the ironic thing is he obviously escaped from the lava.
Right.
Only to be crushed in Looney Tunes fashion.
I didn't know a bone would survive 2,000 years.
Yeah, of course.
It would? Okay. Yeah. I thought they kind of just fell to dust after a while under most circumstances.
Well, it depends on where the body is,
okay.
You know, what the climate's like and stuff. Now, they think that this guy was about 30 years old. They think that he had a bone infection. The funniest thing was they're like, well, his head hasn't been found. I'm like, obviously his head is squished under the rock. I mean,
it's not there. Obviously.
Well, I don't know. They just
haven't. It's not uncovered. That's what they're
saying. But the funniest thing about, the funniest/saddest thing about this is that, I mean, that's a pretty dramatic photo, right? Mm-hmm. With the skeleton crushing the guy's head. So automatically, like, everybody on Twitter goes on there and puts, like, hilarious, you know, they made it into a meme, pretty much. And so some of the best ones, somebody asked if that was the oldest guy to become a meme. Man, oh no, a volcano destroyed my city. Gee whiz, how can this dig in any wood? Wile E. Coyote's great-great-great-great-great-great-grandfather.
Damn. Here's the funny thing is that when that rock hit him, nobody came and picked up his body or buried him, which tells me that that must have happened in like a landslide. It must have hit him and then his body was covered with dirt. Why wouldn't they have?
Yeah, maybe.
Why wouldn't they have rescued his body and just buried him?
I don't know.
He was never found and it wasn't disturbed, which meant that it must have been buried. Must have been a landslide.
Yeah, probably. But yeah, some of the other comments, somebody posted the picture and then underneath they put me to a panicked group of archaeologists moments after I drop a big ass rock on a perfectly preserved Pompeii skeleton.
Yeah.
Chill, let me talk to the press. I got this. And then this was the best. Evidently, this whole Twitter account is called Limericking, so they post little limericks. And their limerick for this was, a fellow was fleeing Pompeii and felt he had gotten away, but then came the shock of a tumbling rock, which is crushing his skull still today.
Oh, man.
I just love that. It's like, we can laugh, you know, it sucks for that guy.
Yeah.
But it was 2,000
years ago. It's a long
time
ago. Yeah.
He's not, so don't haunt me, man. Yeah. I'm just like, you know, that's just,
he
wah,
may have he's probably reincarnated by now.
Yeah, you would, yeah. I would hope so. And I hope he had much, much better luck in his subsequent lives. Because, man, that's some fucked up shit. All right, so that's all the news story I wanted to do. Let's get into talking about this episode of A Haunting.
Yeah.
About Billy Bean. Now, this episode, it was from season 2, episode number 5.
Yeah.
From 2006.
Yeah, and this was back. Aired. This was back when A Haunting was still consistently pretty good.
Well, it was still on Discovery at this point.
Still on Discovery, and yeah, it was still pretty good. Later on, it kind of got a little, I don't know, cheesy in a certain way. Although, you know what, it had a lot of the same actors. It's just that it seemed like they got lazy. They started to just kind of like take any case that came their way, you know?
Well, and remember, wasn't there one from like season 8 or season 9 that was fucking mummies, you guys?
Oh, yeah.
They were like a mummy.
Yeah, they had mummy ones. I think it was. Wasn't it a mummy?
I think it was a mummy. Yeah, it was like some teenage guy and he went to a museum and got like possessed by, I think it was Sobek, the crocodile.
Oh, yeah,
snake god or whatever.
Yeah,
it was.
That's right.
I'm sitting there watching that. The nigger, you fucking serious? Come on now.
Some of the later ones, were they were really reaching.
Yeah.
Really reaching, yeah.
I mean, you know, I think we've said that before, like some of our other discussions about haunting episodes. It does seem like...
they ran out of cases.
Yeah, it seems like a lot of the earlier ones were a lot less outlandish.
Right.
You know, they were just like basically pretty much straight up ghost stories or, you know, poltergeist type stuff. And, you know, you didn't get so much of later on. It was like, just there's demons, there's witches, there's, you know, there's
haunted,
werewolves is all kind of shit.
Yeah, haunted cemeteries and kids tripping out in the cemetery at night, seeing things, you know. And, you know, my mom, the psychic, you know, remember that one?
Oh, yeah, I remember that one.
Yeah.
That one was kind of lame, I thought.
Yeah. Pretty bad.
This one was kind of interesting, though, because this guy kind of became, I don't know how famous he is, really, but he kind of became a little bit famous later, and I'm pretty sure that he was on some later episodes.
Oh, he was.
But I couldn't find which ones they were, but I know he was on some later ones.
I'm not sure. I remember him being in other cases.
Yeah, I think he was, too, as like a consultant. Yeah.
But I'm not really sure that those were haunting episodes. That may have been the one with the animals. What was that called?
That one, I think, is just called The Haunted.
The Haunted,
This is so funny because you could see, I mean, it's Animal Planet. They have, you know, shows about animals, obviously. But they're like, well, man, we want some of that paranormal TV show action. So we're going to make a show that's just called The Haunted.
Right.
And it's like, it'll be pretty much just like A Haunting, except we'll have one scene where the cat is frightened by
noise. Yeah, right. By contract, it has to have something to do with animals. So they'll have a whole damn haunting. And, oh, by the way, they had a cat.
They had a kitty.
They had a kitty. And Kitty saw it, I guess. And then they go on
and then the kitty's in the corner going, and then that's it. They never mentioned the kitty.
Yeah.
Yeah. I love it.
Yeah.
But yeah, I do think he might have been on that show.
I think it was Haunted, I think.
But he was on a bunch of other ones, too.
Yeah, they'd call him in as kind of like an exorcist or some kind of a spiritual advisor.
And, yeah.
Or sometimes he'd go, oh, yeah, I know another family that was haunted, you know. I talked to Billy Bean online one time. He didn't know who I was. I just, you know, started to say, you know, I was involved in a case, you know, it was a lot like yours. And every response was basically him plugging his book, and every response ended with the phrase, God bless.
Yeah.
So, and he must have said that 20 times.
He has gone full out on the, I mean, he has a website, which I went to. And yeah, he bills himself as a spiritual advisor, an exorcist. Yeah. Exorcist is the first thing that he has listed. He calls himself the spiritual warrior. That's right. Like the name of his website. You know, I'm not going to hate on the guy, whatever. I write books. No. I plug my books. He's written four of them.
Yeah.
Only one of them is about his own experiences, though.
Yeah, his case as it's presented in The Haunting actually kind of reminds me a little bit of mine. But
it is very similar, I thought.
Yeah, not as much objects being moved. So, you know, it's just kind of funny to kind of reach out to the guy and maybe try to compare notes. And really, I didn't get anything back other than buy my book, God bless. Buy my book, God bless. You know,
right.
That got old after about four or five times. I'll go, nah, okay, dude. I kind of, you know, question, sometimes it makes you question the motives, you know what I mean? But
yeah.
You know, we'll see.
But this actually was a good episode. As I said, it's from season 2, episode number 5. The episode is actually called House of the Dead, and it stars our beloved forehead lady. She's been in a bunch of different ones. She was in the Bobby Mackie episode, but she just had a bit part. She played a psychic or something. Yeah. And I think I mentioned her when we talked about the Bobby Mackie
forehead lady. Yeah. It's fucking hilarious. She doesn't have a huge forehead. What it is that her hairline
is very far back.
Very, very far back, and it makes her look like kind of have a bulbous forehead. She's a good looking lady, though.
She is, though. Yeah.
She's got it. Yeah.
Although, if that was me, I'd be like, you know, bangs. I mean, I already have bangs.
Yeah.
But I'm
she
just
needs
saying.
Some bangs.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, that's what they tell you to do. Wear some bangs. You can cover that up. It's fine. Okay. But she's like the main part in this. She's the mom. Now, this story took place in Glen Burnie, Maryland in 1970. Mm-hmm. Now, Billy Bean, who is the one who's telling this tale, he was 7 years old at the time. So he's talking about something that happened in his childhood, and this is something that kind of set him along the path of becoming the spiritual warrior that he is today.
Yeah, spiritual warrior. I like how you say that. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's pretty cool.
He called himself that. I didn't make that up.
No, I'm enjoying it. I'm appreciating it.
Okay, so this whole family moves to this house. It's the first house they had bought. Okay, so the mom's name is Patricia. The dad's name is Bill.
I just thought of something.
What did you think of?
If he's a spiritual warrior, what does that make me?
Well, I don't know. You have to just come to that.
I got
to
call it right.
You have to come up with your own self-identification. Okay. What would you like to be called?
I don't know. I'm going to let the audience make that up. You know, spiritual.
I don't know if that's a good idea.
Spiritual dickhead. You are a spiritual dickhead. Yeah. Anyway, I'm just having fun.
Oh my God, that's the next T-shirt design. I'm gonna put your little face on there, and it's gonna say Tom Ross, spiritual dickhead. Yeah. Okay. All right. So.
All right. Back up. You know, because I fucked it up. Go ahead.
No, you didn't.
Okay. Back up. Start over.
All right. So Bill and Patricia are the parents, right? So they have two kids. Billy Bean, who is 7. He has a brother named Bobby. They don't say how old that kid... This kid, the poor kid that plays Bobby, didn't even get a line.
Right.
He was younger, so I'm assuming he was 4 or 5. And he also has an older sister named Patty, who is 14 at the time. This was in 1970. And she's also interviewed on the program and has some pretty alarming hair.
Damn.
It was filmed in 2006. Okay, you remember that episode of Kitchen Nightmares that took place? You know exactly which one I'm going to say.
The one took place in Michigan?
In Michigan, where all the women, and even though it was the 2000s, all the women had terrible 80s feathered heavy metal.
They still look like
grippy
that.
Hair.
They still look like that.
This is kind of what this woman's hair looked like. Except it kind of looked like a cone in the middle. It was like very cone-like. It was very strange. But yeah, so that was his sister.
Okay.
And she's interviewed on the show as well.
Michigan is the American equivalent of Siberia.
It is. It is in a way.
Siberia. Yeah.
Yeah. It's really weird how.
Yeah, I lived there for a couple years.
Yeah, but even when we saw that episode of Kitchen Nightmares, I can't. What the hell was the name of that restaurant? The Handlebar? Something.
No, the Handlebar was the one from Gordon Ramsay. That's the one twisted. Dee Snider from Twisted's sister showed up.
Well, I thought that was it. Right.
No,
I don't know. No. But yeah, so there was this one in Michigan somewhere, and like the waitresses and the people that I was like, oh my God, it's like 1986.
Yeah.
But it wasn't. It was like 2011 or some shit. Everybody looked like it was 1986.
Every waitress had like a cockatiel on her head.
And all the guys had like mullets and jean jackets.
Yeah.
I'm like, wow.
Yeah.
I didn't realize that there were some parts of the country that were that far out of the loop.
That far back, yeah.
You would think, I mean, now that we have the internet, but whatever. Yeah, okay, so this is the Beans' first house. They move into this house. Now, pretty much as soon as they move in, Billy and Patty complain about particularly the hallway that leads to the bedrooms being like super, super creepy.
Cold spots. Feeling watched.
Oppressive. Like people are watching them. Patty specifically, she said her bedroom was at the end of the hall.
Right.
And she said it was always, always cold. There was like nothing you could do about it. And she always just had a really creepy feeling like walking around oppressive. In there.
That immediately came to my attention because that's the way the ski lodge was at Mammoth Mountain that I went to. That's how it starts.
So at first, neither one of those two kids seemed to really like it.
And it was from the second we walked in there, as if it was just lying there in wait for you, which is weird.
And then the next thing that happens is kind of a bigger thing. It was more like poltergeist activity. So apparently, the mom is in the living room cleaning something up, and she starts hearing one of the bedroom doors like slamming, like over like bam, 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 like over and over again. Yeah. So she goes down the hall thinking that one of the kids is being an asshat and like slaps and, you know, slamming the door. And Billy is sitting there on the bed in his bedroom and he's just sitting there staring at the door and it's just doing it by itself.
Oh, really? He saw it doing it by itself?
That's what he says.
That's what he said? Okay.
So now the mom didn't see it doing that.
Right.
She just heard it and she came running in there and is like, hey, why are you slamming the door? And he's like sitting there going, I wasn't slamming the door. He's like, he was just sitting there staring at it like terrified. And she's like, well, whatever, just don't do it anymore. And you're so loud, blah, blah, blah. He said that really freaked him out a lot because, and he said it freaked him out even worse when his mom came and like didn't believe him.
Right.
That he hadn't been doing it. He's like, I was just sitting there on my bed looking at it and it was doing that. But then some shit happens that makes the mom think that maybe there is some weird shit going on in this house. So I'm not real sure how long it seems like it hasn't been that long since they've moved in, but you know, she's a stay at home mom. So the kids go off to school. The dad goes off to work. He's a contractor or something. And she's in the house. She hears the door banging by itself again. She goes to check it out and there's nobody there.
Now the door we're talking about is the door to his room, right?
Yeah.
To Billy's room.
It looked like, yeah.
Okay.
Well, it's actually Billy and Bobby's room because it looked like both the boys slept in one bedroom.
Gotcha.
Yeah. And then the daughter had her own room too. Because she was in one of the other rooms making the beds. And then she heard that and she went in there to check and she couldn't see anybody.
Right.
And then when she comes back into the other bedroom, the beds are all fucked up again, even though she just made them.
Now, here's the thing. This is very much how Mammoth Mountain Poltergeist.
That's what I said. That really reminded me of your shit.
In the program, I was not really able to put a finger on or get an idea of what the time frame was.
Yeah.
Was this all in the same day or was this the same week? They never really make it clear, do they?
No. Sometimes the narrator will say months go by or a year went by or something like that.
Right.
But with these first manifestations of these first disturbances, they don't really say. So I'm assuming it was just over the first couple of months.
Right. It's probably spelled out a lot better in Billy's book.
Yeah.
Which we'll have to plug the book.
He did write a book. It's called Dark Force or Dark Forces. One of those two things. But
I think it's Dark Forces, I think.
Yeah. That's actually about this particular case. And it's interesting because the way that they dramatized it on a haunting, I actually found another account of it on like an evangelical blog, like somebody had written about it. And they added a few things that were not in the show.
Okay.
And some things are a little different.
Today.
Yeah, I'll just mention that. It's not like a huge amount of things. Yeah, so she had made the beds and she goes in there to investigate the banging and then she comes back and the beds are all messed up again. And she's like, what the hell? She's like, I just did it. Okay, so then the phone rings and it's her mom. And so she says to her mom, she's like, I think I'm losing my mind. I just made the beds and then I came back in the room and they were all messed up again. What the hell? This shit's haunted.
Yeah.
I mean, pretty much she jumped right to that conclusion.
Right. Sounds like what happened in my case.
Yeah.
All right.
Now, while she's talking on the phone to her mom, she hears something that sounds like the bathroom faucets coming on by themselves. So she says, okay, well, hold on a second, mom. I got to go check this out. So she goes down the hall to the bathroom and both the bathroom faucets are on full blast. They have filled up the sink basin and have flooded over and all the water is coming out from underneath the door and coming into the hallway. So the first thing she tries to do, she's trying to tell her mom, she's like, look, all this stuff is happening. And it looked like you said, it looked like it all happened on a single day because it looked like, you know, she went to do this and then this happened and she went to do that and that. So she was like talking to her mom on the phone and Billy has come home from school and he overhears his mom telling her mom on the phone about the faucets and about the door and everything. And he's like starting to wig out because he's like, oh man. He's like, because he was creeped out from the beginning. So now this is like validation. He's like, my mom is seeing it too. Now, of course, just like in 99% of episodes of The Haunting, they try to tell the dad, Bill, and he's just kind of like,
yeah,
like, whatever.
Yeah.
Whatever. Women and children, you guys don't know anything.
Yeah.
You guys don't know how reality works.
Yeah. Women don't know how reality works.
We seriously don't.
I like that.
I have no idea.
I'm going to take that on as my own personal.
motto. Your mantra.
Women don't know how reality works.
According to every dad in a haunting,
yeah.
Then that is the case.
You guys are just scared.
Yeah.
You know what I'm talking, just scared.
They kept, because she said, look, dude, she's like, yeah. I made the beds and then I left the room for a couple seconds and I came out, the beds are all fucked up. And he's like, oh, well, you're just tired and you forgot.
Yeah, in my case, that's how it started. That kind of stuff.
Yeah.
Beds would get messed up, but our main thing was this little folded up hand towels being moved around.
Yeah.
That was the most common one. I'm going to plug my book at the end of this book, at the end of this show, too.
You always,
I'm going to plug his book, do. I'm going to plug mine. You know, I'm going to do my job.
That's fair.
And I'm going to give my opinion, and this my analysis of this case when you're done.
Okay.
After the end of the break.
So now at this point, they show kind of a scene where they're all at the dinner table, and the mom is just be like, no, seriously, there's some weird shit in this house. And he's just like, whatever, woman, it's, you know, nothing. And then the daughter is also like, I don't like this house. This isn't my house. I don't want to live here anymore. I'm going to my boyfriend's house. I'm out.
Right.
So she fucks off.
Right.
So there's this kind of dynamic developing again, as like I said, and that happens a lot in these types of family situations on this show. Another thing that seemed to happen a lot, and this was another thing that they showed, was that Billy and I believe Patty, they didn't interview Bobby. I don't know whatever happened to that kid. And like I said, the kid that played him in the show didn't even get a line. I think he was just on the screen a couple of times. He didn't factor into anything. So both Billy and Patty reported that they often heard what sounded like really heavy footsteps on the ceiling or on the roof. Like when they were in bed at night, they would hear all this. Somebody, it sounded like somebody walking around.
Right.
Like in the attic or on the roof or whatever, that had heavy boots on. And I said, it's really interesting because that my grandfather's house when I was a kid that I lived in for many years and that my mom and all her siblings grew up in, that was one of the exact same things they reported. They said they always heard somebody walking around on the roof. They said it sounded like a sea captain, like walking back and forth across the deck. They said it sounded exactly like
and
that.
And to clarify,
I never heard it, but they did.
You never heard it, right.
No, but they all did.
I've experienced poltergeist phenomenon before, so did all my family during Mammoth Mountain Poltergeist, which we wrote a book about in case you're a new listener. And poltergeist phenomenon, I do not believe is coming from spirits of the dead, although it can manifest certain effects that sound very ghostly and that seem very ghostly, which I'll get more into that later. But so far in the case, I'm believing what Billy's telling.
Yeah.
It's very similar to what I saw. His explanation for it's going to be very different than mine. He's going to say supernatural. I'm going to just say paranormal, you know, which we'll get to that in a bit.
The funniest thing about this is that the kid tries to tell the dad that he hears footsteps up on the ceiling at night. And his dad tries to say it's a squirrel, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Which I think is very funny. And then
squirrels wear boots, you know?
Yeah, the kid had the funniest line. He's like, squirrels don't wear boots.
Yeah,
and he's
okay.
Like, oh, yeah, you got me there.
Yeah, yeah.
And I was like, yeah, he did get you.
Yeah.
He's like, I know what a squirrel sounds like, for heaven's sake. He said it sounded like a person walking around.
Yeah.
But yeah. Then, you know, the narrator says, okay, months are going by at this point. Billy says that his dad's personality begins to change. And this is another thing that we see on a lot of episodes of A Haunting, where seemingly the man of the house, who initially starts out as this skeptical, poo-pooing kind of, you guys don't know what you're talking about, but then insidiously becomes like possessed, evidently, by this entity or entities. And he's arguing that that's kind of what happened. Now he's like, previously he had been a cool dad. Him and his mom had been, you know, really in love and everything. But then the longer they lived there, he starts becoming a drunk.
Yeah.
He said his business started to fail. They're like, he would be gone for like 2 or 3 days at a time. He'd be coming home drunk all the time. And he started to become very verbally abusive, looked like even physically abusive toward the wife, would kind of like slam her against the wall and smack her around and stuff. So Billy is arguing that he thinks that the house or something inside the house was getting to his dad and
like
turning
possession.
Him like a possession type.
Right.
He didn't use that word, but I think that's what he was getting at.
I have a different explanation for that. What I think it is that some guys are just very, very stubborn and very materialistic, and they're not going to believe in the unseen or the supernatural.
Right.
So when they're confronted with it, they go into denial.
Yeah, they double down on it.
They double down on it.
Yeah.
And as the phenomena continues, it's bad on their mental health. They start going deeper and deeper into denial.
Because they can't just roll with it.
They can't roll with it, and they can't make the admission to themselves and to others that they were wrong.
Yeah.
So they start to decline into insanity.
I definitely think you probably got something.
That's what I think it is. Yeah. They ended up in a kind of a nightmarish insanity.
Yeah.
And they start lashing out and abusing other people.
Yeah.
I don't really think it's possession.
I don't think so either.
I think it's insanity.
Yeah, and I think that might be too. And right. like you said, they're lashing out against usually the wife and the children because they were the ones that saw it first and they right. accept that it's right. happening.
And they can't.
And that makes him angry.
And they can't lash out at something that they deny its existence to. In other words, right. you know, they're saying, there is no ghost. You know, I'm going to attack you.
Yeah.
You know, basically.
Because you're right here.
Yeah, so I can't attack right the ghost because there is no ghost. So I'm going to attack you.
Yeah. That's,
you know, but they're seeing the ghost.
Yeah.
Or I'm going to call it a ghost. For all intents and purposes, it's a ghost. I think it's an artificial ghost, you know, created by basically a psychic temper tantrum from little kids.
So he starts becoming abusive and he's insisting, you know, he's saying, oh, you just want to move and I don't want to move and all this other kind of shit. And he's just flipping out about it. So actually, let's take a break right now.
It's a good time to take a break.
And then when we come back, we'll kind of talk about the rest of the case. And I'll fill in a couple of little details.
I can't believe we're halfway through the show.
Yeah, we just blabbed and blabbed.
I know, man.
Okay. All right. So we're going to take a short break and then we'll be back in just a couple of minutes. Okay, we're back. So we're at the point now where Billy's talking about his dad, Bill, how he's really turning into a douche canoe and how he said, I really just started to hate him and right. fear him because he just seemed, you know, to be turning into someone else. So then evidently there's an incident where the kid, he hears the footsteps on the ceiling again when he's sleeping. But then it kind of ramps up to, he has kind of like a hag syndrome type of thing where he feels like something's pressing down on him or something is like forcing him down. Yeah.
It's very common.
Very common.
Very common to commonly reported phenomenon yeah. in this type of poltergeist case.
And yeah. he said that he was trying to scream for his parents and he couldn't say anything, like nothing, no sound would come
it's
out.
It's sleep paralysis.
Yeah, that's what it sounds
it's
like.
Modified sleep paralysis, because I believe that these poltergeist episodes are actually a modified form of astral projection. It's like a spontaneous out-of-body experience, I believe. That can happen in certain types of sleep. You know what I mean? Like, kind of like in that area in between wakefulness and sleep. That's really when I had
what do they call that state? Hypnagogic? Yeah. I'm not sure if I'm pronouncing that right. Probably not.
Because in the book that Jenny wrote about my case, and later on after I had my poltergeist episode, as I was falling asleep, I went into this really weird state of being in between awake and asleep, and I had an out-of-body experience that someone else witnessed when I was in the Army. And during that time, if I didn't know what was going on, I'd probably have that same feeling of, you know, being paralyzed and something on top of me. It was a little bit familiar with what was going on in my case, so I just kind of rolled with it. I didn't fight it. If you fight it, you'll feel like you're paralyzed.
But that's what, I mean, what they showed on the reenactment was, they didn't show a figure or anything. They just kind of showed like a quickly edited thing of him
yeah.
sort of being forced down on the bed and like sort of, you know,
I just see this as
manipulated around.
I see this as evidence that he was entering into altered states of consciousness at certain times and it was producing phenomena.
And then evidently after he came out of that state, he sits up and he said he clearly saw an apparition.
Yeah. Oh, okay. Yeah.
Of
yeah,
a
yeah.
woman standing at the end of his bed, like looking sadly yeah. at him.
That's the time in which you see apparitions because yeah. I guess you could say dreamlike state and wakeful type state is being mixed into the same conscious realm. I'm sure a lot of people know exactly what I'm talking about. You wake up from a deep sleep, you're paralyzed, and you look at the end of the bed and there's someone standing there.
Yeah.
You even had it. You thought there was a man standing at the foot of the bed with a baseball bat.
Yep.
It's not a ghost. It's dream material from
yeah.
your subconscious being kind of superimposed.
And
over
for a
what
second, I didn't think it was a ghost. I thought it was a person. I thought somebody had broken into my apartment.
Yeah, he's going. He's kind of, because of the stress of the family situation, he's getting into really weird states of consciousness.
Yeah.
That's what I'm interested in.
But yeah, so he clearly said he saw that it didn't do anything. He didn't say that it looked scary. He just said it looked like a woman and she looked kind of sad and that she right. was looking at him. And then when he was freaked out, so he put the blanket over his head, and then when he took the blanket yeah. she was gone.
It makes me wonder if you're in that mental state, are you a little bit more psychically aware? Could you actually see something that maybe used to be in that area? Like maybe that was a person that used to live in that house.
Yeah, like maybe you're kind of plugged into the ether
exactly,
type of thing.
Exactly. You yeah. know what I mean? But I don't really like put a whole lot of weight in apparitions. Even if I know I'm seeing the apparition, I'm going to know that, say, for instance, let's say it was a ghost. A ghost is going to appear any way it wants you to see it. Let's say I'm seeing a ghost, and I see the ghost, and it's the ghost of a woman, or at least it seems like a woman. Is it really the ghost of a woman, or is it a ghost of something else, and it wants to appear as a woman?
Right.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I don't really put much weight into,
and they kind of get into that on some of the episodes of A Haunting, where like Sally's house, which we also did an episode on,
yeah.
where they kind of suspected that the entity, which they thought was a demon, but they said it was pretending to be
a ghost
of a little girl,
right.
like to kind of insinuate itself
yeah.
into this. So that's kind of a common theme on some
yeah,
of these
I don't believe
shows.
Apparitions, even though I've seen things that were like apparitions, like the blue haze
yeah.
in my case. An apparition isn't proof of the nature of whatever it is. Just because it seems to be a woman, that doesn't mean it's a woman. You know, just because it's a blue haze, that doesn't mean it's a blue haze. It's just, you're just experiencing some kind of weird anomaly, and your brain's trying to make sense out of it.
So evidently, this terrified Billy so much, he runs into his parents' room and wants to sleep in there with them, or wants his mom to sleep in the room with him. But of course, the dickhead dad is all just like, no, you go back to your room and be a man, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And the kid is like, I am not going back in that fucking room. So he just went and slept on the couch.
Yeah, and he said that was a life-changing experience, which I can understand that, because, you know.
Yeah, he said it was a huge, huge trauma.
Yeah, I was lucky to have had my case with my aunt and uncle, because they experienced it along with me. And they knew it was a reality. I couldn't imagine what it would be like to be in that poltergeist.
Well, yeah, I mean,
when people were telling you, that's not real.
Yeah.
And you're seeing it. You know, you'd think you were crazy.
I mean, at least his mom had experienced it
too. Some of it, right, yeah.
But I think the dynamic of the family, if it really did happen the way he's saying, the dynamic of the family was such that the father seemed kind of controlling, and it was his disbelief that was kind of, you know, reigning over the day. So I feel like he was not protecting the children, and he wasn't allowing the mother to protect the children.
Yeah.
So, you know, if you're a 7-year-old kid and you're seeing
right.
ghosts and shit in your room,
right.
and then you feel like your parents are not going to help you, or they don't believe you, or they can't protect you,
mm-hmm.
that has to be really, I mean, so I can understand the fact of him saying that it was a really traumatic experience
yeah.
for him, because it would be.
Just because he's seeing apparitions of women, I don't believe it's a ghost. I mean, in every good poltergeist case I've ever come across in my studies, they always mention apparitions. And those apparitions are just across the board. The apparition is whatever a person thinks they saw.
Yeah.
You know, like even in Enfield, one of the witnesses reported seeing a man in the kitchen. And there's no reason to believe that there was a man or the ghost of a man in Enfield poltergeist case. You know what I mean? It's just, it may have been a fake ghost of a man. I don't believe it was a real ghost of a man.
So at this point in the show, they kind of skip ahead 2 years. They sort of say, you know, that the most common manifestation, it seems like, was the footsteps. They said they heard that pretty much all the time. They talk about faucets going on and off, you know, stuff being moved or flying around. But so after 2 years, there was an incident where Patty, the older daughter, who is at 16 at this point, she is sleeping in her room. She wakes up and she hears the footsteps on the ceiling again. And then she says she very distinctly feels something touching her leg, like a person. Wow. But she said she immediately knew it was not a person.
Right.
She said she just knew. So she jumps out of bed, starts screaming and freaking out. And for her, that was pretty much the last straw. She's like, because not only is this house creepy and she hated it there, but all the shit with the family, just not getting along, and there was all this, you know, kind of rancor between all the family members. And so, you know, even though she was only 16, she pretty much just married her boyfriend at the time and moved out and went and moved in with him. And she even said on the show, and I was like, I thought this was kind of funny. She even says in the show, she's like, it wouldn't have mattered who my boyfriend was at the time.
Yeah.
I just wanted to get the hell out of the house. So she just would have married anybody that was there, I guess.
There was a lot of that going on in those days anyway.
Well, yeah. It was a way to escape your situation.
Exactly. It's a way to escape your parents. And parents evidently were a handful back in the 60s and 70s.
I guess they must have been.
Yeah.
Mine were cool, but you know.
Yeah.
So she was only 16 years old. I mean, obviously, I'm sure it didn't last, but especially since she talked about him that way, she was just like, he was just a guy to get me out of my house.
I'm sure
it didn't. She was 16 years old. But so she married and moved out. They moved to a house not too far away from the parents' house. So she leaves. Shortly after this, they show the remaining members of the family, and they're kind of sitting around the dinner table looking all bummed out because the mom, you know, hadn't wanted her to leave. She thought it was, you know, she advised Patty against it, but, you know, there wasn't anything she could say. So they're all sitting there all bummed out. And then the dad suddenly decides, he's like, he just gets up with his drink in his hand. He puts on his coat. He says, I'm going for a walk, and he leaves the house and he never returns.
Right.
So I'm like,
yeah, he had another woman.
He must have been, I mean, I don't know how it really went. Like, it looked like in the show, like he just got up from the dinner table and just walked out the door and didn't take any of the shit or anything, which I thought was kind of funny. Because, you know, there's always that funny, those funny stories.
Where'd you go, a kid at a pack of cigarettes?
And never came home, right? Yeah. It was kind of that kind of situation, which it very well might have been. But, you know, you would think that he had probably been planning this for a while. And like I said, even for the past couple of years, he'd been kind of a drunk. His business had been failing. He'd had other problems. And like you said, he might have been seeing somebody on the side. It seems very likely. Yeah. So,
well, they said earlier that he'd be out drinking and gone for days. So he had to be sleeping somewhere.
Yeah, exactly.
So he found a woman.
So yeah, so he basically just took off.
Right.
And Billy, who was interviewed on the show, he said it's actually ironic because his dad was the one that had been fighting so hard to stay in the house and he didn't want to move. You bitch, why do you want to move out of the house?
Right.
I did all this. I saved up to buy this house. And then he was the one that just took off and left her and the kids there alone.
It's a typical, you know, hard-ass move.
Yeah.
You know what I'm talking about? He's going to deny that the paranormal phenomenon is going on. He's going to double down on the denial. And he's going to go insane and then he's going to run. That's what they did. It was a pretty common pattern. It was almost kind of like that in the Summerwind case. Instead of him running, he drove the wife and the kids out.
Where is that raccoon?
Remember?
Yeah, because he was just in there
playing his organ, keeping everybody awake. I do what I want to do.
Playing his organ. Yeah, yeah. That wasn't a euphemism. He actually was playing an actual organ, like
that's
a piano.
Right. Burning all the furniture to heat the house.
He wasn't keeping everyone awake masturbating.
I do what I want to do.
So shortly after he leaves, Patricia has an incident where she wakes up in her bedroom and she sees an apparition of a man on top of her strangling her.
Right.
Now, this man, she said, now the reenactment of it, he looked like kind of a chubby bald dude, but she said she didn't say it because she's passed away, but the most distinctive thing about him was he had this big, huge scar on one side of his face. And he had what looked like streaks of blood in his hair or on his head. So that freaks her out. She basically runs into her son's room and sleeps in there with them. And Billy said from that point forward, they all slept in the same room.
Now, how old was Billy at this time? Do we know? About 7, 8, 9?
Well, he was 7 when they moved in, and this was about 2 years later. So he's 9, 10.
Okay.
Somewhere around there. But yeah, so now they're all sleeping in the boys' room.
That is not the ideal age to be a poltergeist focus.
Well, the girl was 14 when they moved in.
Right.
But shit still happened after she moved out.
But she didn't move that far away, did she?
It seemed like it was. They didn't say exactly, but it wasn't far.
I've heard of poltergeist focuses being younger within the ages of puberty also. So it could have been more of a group synergy also. Think about it. The mom was seeing apparitions also. And it kind of reminds me of the Enfield case where Janet and then her sister would go into weird trance-like states while they were in bed. And one of them would say something and the other one would like complete the sentence back and forth while they were asleep. And sometimes a weird synergy builds up between children in a poltergeist case. And maybe family members too. You know, so I think there was some kind of a family synergy going on.
But yeah, so the next thing that happens, they show Patricia, she's making lunch for the boys. They're both sitting at the table. I kind of laughed at this because they both have their little hot dogs on their little plates. And then she's putting peas on their plates. And I was like, oh. And then one of the boys, I guess it was Billy, he was kind of like, Mom, I don't like peas. Don't you remember? And I was like, oh my God, I was that kid. I like peas now, but I didn't when I was growing up.
I made you like peas.
You did, yeah. Because I was grossed out by them for a really long time. For
a broker of that. I just made some split pea soup.
Yeah.
And she's, this soup is pretty good.
Yeah, you actually got me. I had a weird phobia about eating peas. Didn't make any sense. I don't know where. Well, it didn't make any sense to me either. Right, I was trying to figure it out. I've had it. I remembered having it when I was 5 or 6 years old. So it must have been something traumatic that happened to me. Yeah. Maybe I got really sick and threw up peas when I was little or something. I didn't remember.
So what I did was I just made her confront it. I made from scratch some really good split pea soup. I had the damn dried split peas and everything. A big old ham bone. Remember that? With all the ham. And made some delicious split pea soup.
It was delicious.
But you couldn't see any peas in it. I had them all kind of mashed up. I had to be
slowly broken of it.
Right. And she tasted it. And she goes, this tastes good. And I said, yeah, it's good. Yeah. And then later on, gave her some peas. And says, it tastes just like that soup. And it got you out of it somehow.
Yeah. Because I think it wasn't even so much the taste of it that grossed me out. It was like the idea of them. Yeah. Like they're these little round squishy. I don't know. I was like weirded out by it. Yeah, it didn't. I didn't like the smell of them either.
It didn't make sense to me.
It didn't. Weird. But now you make Indian dishes like mutter paneer and stuff like that. They're pretty much all peas.
Yeah,
and they look like peas. Yeah. And I can eat it with no problem.
Yeah, you love it. Seems like it.
Yeah. He's a really good chef, in case I never mentioned that.
That's right.
But yeah, he did get me over
those guys down in Australia are clapping. They're on the line clapping. I know the deal. I work on a line.
Yeah, so while she's scooping the peas back off of Billy's plate because he doesn't like them.
Yeah.
And she didn't remember. She's like, oh, I forgot all about that. And then she collapses on the floor. So the kid, this is why I'm assuming that the sister and the sister's husband live close by, because they called the sister rather than calling an ambulance. I know they didn't have 911 in 1972, I don't think. Because that was the year I was born, and I'm pretty sure I remember when they instituted 911, which I think it was in the mid-70s. Ooh. So they didn't have it back then. So if you didn't know the number of the police or the ambulance, you were kind of screwed. So you had to kind of call somebody you knew. Right. So Billy calls the sister and says, hey, Mom just collapsed on the floor and I don't know what's wrong with her. So they take her to the hospital, and it turns out that she has had a mild stroke.
Weird.
And she wasn't that old, it didn't seem like.
It's almost kind of like the stress of the environment maybe got
to it. It probably was. I mean, I would imagine.
Which kind of adds to my idea that it was a very emotional, negatively charged environment, which that's a great place for poltergeist phenomenon to occur.
But the sad thing is that while she's in the hospital, they also discover, they're like, well, okay, the stroke was just mild, so she'll probably be fine from that. But then they find out that her kidneys are failing and that she will ultimately need dialysis.
Right.
So they send her home. They say she's mostly fine for the time, but eventually she's going to need dialysis. Now, at this stage, her mom is like, her mom did seem to believe that the house was haunted and that there were entities in the house that were causing these health problems. So she's basically like, you need to move. Now, the weird thing is that at this stage, Patricia is like, no, I don't want to move. Now, I don't know if it was because, I mean, Billy seemed to think, oh, well, the entities were probably keeping her there. But also, it might have been a financial issue, too, because you can't, I mean, now she has all these health problems. She can't work. She has three kids she has to, or she has two kids. The other one moved away. She's running this house on her own, and she doesn't really have the money to just pick up and leave. And I think that's what a lot of people are just like, I don't know, the house is haunted. And they're like, why don't you just move? It's like, because I don't have thousands of dollars.
A lot of people ask us that, you know, why didn't you just leave? Well, we didn't have where to go.
Yeah, where are we going to go? And and I think that happens a lot, too, with these, particularly if you buy a house or, you know, it's expensive to move, even if you're renting. Right. You have to put big deposits down, and people don't have that kind of money just like hanging out. So, you know, she couldn't leave. So then the next thing that happened in the reenactment was that Patricia is shown, the kids are in bed, she's in the kitchen, and she's making tea or something, and she starts hearing all the glasses rattling by themselves in the cupboard. So she turns around and she opens it like, what the hell is that all about? And then one of the glass, it's either a glass or a mug, and it flies out at her and hits her right in the face and like slices her face open to a stage where, again, the kids have to call the sister to come and take her to the hospital because she needs stitches.
Now, were there witnesses to this, according to the show?
No, it looked like she was in the kitchen by herself. Okay. And then she fell on the floor and her face was all bloody and she yelled for the kids and were like, hey, call your sister. I need stitches because this glass just flew in my face.
So we're not really sure that that happened exactly the way that Billy's saying it is.
Right. I mean, he wasn't Although at this stage, in the interview, Billy is saying this was pretty much a daily nightmare. You know, there was just stuff happening all the time, stuff particularly targeted toward his mother. And that even at this age, he was 9 or 10 at this stage. And he was saying that basically he didn't use the word suicidal. He said he would go out in the yard and just pray to be taken away or whatever.
One of the things that goes against my poltergeist / RSPK, which is recurrent spontaneous psychokinesis theory that I have about this case, one of the things that goes against it is that we're already talking about 3 years.
Yeah, this went on a long time.
Right, and true poltergeist cases, or the really good poltergeist cases that had a lot of witnesses, they didn't go on for very long. 18 months would have been a long time. So 3 years, I mean, mine only lasted a few weeks, a week, really, you know, so.
But yeah, I believe they lived in this house for about 10 years, I want to say.
It makes me wonder, it sounds so much like classic poltergeist, but, you know, the length of it almost kind of sounds like interactive haunting, but.
Well, and something else that's interesting too, like a couple months after her whole cutting face incident, she starts dating this other guy. She meets a guy and his name is Richard Tyson. He was also interviewed on the show. So they kind of start a relationship. Now, Richard is over at the house fixing stuff one day, and he's outside and he looks in through the kitchen window and he sees the sad-faced woman, which apparently was the same apparition that Billy saw. Now, at first he thinks that it's Patricia, so he runs inside the house and he doesn't see anybody. And then he says to Patricia, were you just in here? And she's like, no, I was in the bedroom with the boys or whatever. He's like, I just saw a woman standing right here.
Yeah.
He's like, is this house haunted? And she's like, no, it's fine. It's fine. And he's like, if this house is haunted, you need to get the hell out of here.
Right. But see, then.
But she was like, no, I can't leave. It's, you know, I can't afford it. It's fine.
But here's another thing that kind of goes against the interactive haunting theory. Interactive hauntings usually are not destructive and they don't tend to move objects, just apparitions usually. It's weird. It's a weird mixture of case.
That's what I mean. It is very strange.
Yeah. I mean, I'm not going to say it's a hoax. It sounds like poltergeist.
Yeah.
A mixture of regular poltergeist mixed with, I don't know, maybe some fabrication or maybe some confusion about things. I don't know. I wasn't there. Parts of the case sound very good and other parts of it don't. That's just what I'm saying.
So then the next thing that happens, and this is one of the weirdest things, okay? So the family had a dog. I think his name was Fuzzy. I don't think they mentioned it on the show, but I saw it mentioned somewhere else.
All right.
So Richard, the new boyfriend, has slept over, and him and Patricia wake up one morning, and they pull back the covers, and the bed is full of dog hair.
Yeah, this is a weird part of the case.
And then they get up, they're like flipping out, like, what the fuck? It's dog hair. And then they get out of the bed, and then the dog hair is all over the floor.
Yeah, it's like big clumps of it.
There's like big clumps of it, and it's like into the hall, and he said, and he went into the bathroom, and the basin of the sink was full of dog hair.
Yeah. Evidently big clumps according to what they show.
Yeah, it looked like big clumps. And the guy that they interviewed, like I said, they interviewed Richard on the show.
Yeah, who, you know, it's good that there's an outside witness to this too. Yeah.
And he said there's just dog hair all over the place. And he's like, we spent a whole entire week. We got all the neighbors to look for that dog. Never found the dog.
And no,
it was just hair everywhere.
And no sign that the dog had been injured. There was no blood or anything. Just
no, it was just everywhere. Hair. And it was just in the bed and it was in the sink and everything.
And the dog was gone.
Like, yeah, and the dog just disappeared and they never found the dog.
It's almost like the dog had been molested in some way by the ghost.
Yeah. So at this point, they finally call a priest who comes and blesses the house. Now, the blessing seems uneventful. Billy seems to think it's kind of cool that, because the priest says, well, I'm going to leave this holy water and this Bible here. So in case, you know, after I leave, some other bad shit happens, then you can do your own intercessory prayer and kind of sprinkle holy water around and whatnot and read out of the Bible and it'll be fine. So he leaves and it's fine. But then I don't know how long it was between the time that the priest left and this final onslaught. But what happened? They show the family and Richard is like, hey, let's take the kids to go get ice cream or whatever. They're all sitting in the living room. And then all of a sudden, shit starts flying off all the shelves. There's like books flying and lamps flying and shit just come flying at them from all over the...
This is where the ghostly warrior aspect comes in. Spiritual warrior.
Right.
Tell him what he does.
Because at this point, they're all ducking down.
I love this part of the
fucking episode. I know, it's great. They're all like ducking down, trying not to get hit by the flying books and whatnot.
Yeah.
And then Billy Bean, who I guess is, not like I said, 9 or 10 years old at this stage, he decides he is no longer having it.
He can't take it anymore.
And he picks up the holy water and the Bible that the priest has left, and he stands up and he's like, I cast you out. I don't remember what he said, but he's just, you know, he's like flinging holy water around. He's
preaching and exercising.
Jesus in the name of blah, 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 like that. And it's funny because even in the reenactment, it seemed like it wasn't really helping because shit was still flying at him. And Richard still had to be like, hey, duck down. There's a lamp coming at your head, so you might want to like avoid that. So
it's a cool scene from the episode.
It really is. Yeah. And I tried to get, because what I do is I go through and I try to take screenshots. You know, I kind of scrub through the episode and try to take screenshots. And I was trying to get some good screenshots of all the shit flying around, but it's kind of hard to capture because it just looks like blurs and everything. But, you know, so, but I did get a couple shots of like the lamp and smashing against the TV and whatnot. But yeah, so evidently, I don't know if his intercession worked because the next scene, they show the whole family with their little suitcases running the fuck out of the house and getting in the car and beating cheeks and getting the fuck out of there. So they moved out. Now, evidently, somebody teased me for saying evidently all the time.
Yeah.
I do that. But my excuse was, I like to say evidently or apparently because I said I don't want, in case.
And you also say and stuff like that.
Yeah, I do say
and stuff like that.
I know. I do try to take some of it out because I don't realize, I don't script any of this shit. Yeah. So, so sometimes I don't realize what I'm, because I go off on a tear and I don't realize what I'm saying. So, but then when I listen to it back, I'm like, huh, so I try to take it out if it's not too, but.
And stuff like that.
Man, suck a dick.
Okay, let's wrap it up.
All right, so they leave.
Yeah.
Now, 10 months after they move out of the house, they lived in the house for 10 years.
Yeah.
Right. 10 months later, Patricia dies of a cerebral hemorrhage.
Yeah.
Billy is convinced that it was the entities in the house. They caused all these health problems because evidently she died fairly young. Now, the dad also died, although they didn't say when that was or where that was, but they said he's also dead.
Right.
Now, Billy said on the show, he's like, I really wish that my parents had done a better job of protecting us because I feel like our childhoods were robbed because our whole entire, I mean, it was 10 years that they lived in this house. Our whole childhood was taken up with this bullshit, with these ghosts and everything. Now, Billy apparently did not even tell this story until, well, the first time he told the story was in 2002 because evidently he had told the story in some, you know, minor capacity somewhere, and a radio host in Baltimore heard about it and had him on the radio show. So he came on, and that was subsequently how he got on a haunting and everything. So a guy named John Romine heard him on the radio in 2002 and contacted him. And he said, you know, I've been writing a book about the area, and there have apparently been a bunch of other houses in the same area where the house you grew up that had similar disturbances. And he said that the land that these houses used to be, the land that these houses were built on, used to be like a rifle range and a tent city for soldiers, like in the early 1900s. He's like, one of the people that he had discovered had been injured and later died in that area was a guy who had a similar scar on his face as the scar that the apparition that Patricia had seen.
Right.
This guy's name was apparently Edward Ziprian, and the scar was from a rifle backfire. It was like a misfire. It
must be an explosion.
Right. Like it basically blew up in his face.
Right, yeah.
And that didn't kill him, but he died a few years later, and he was supposedly really pissy and angry about it. Mm. And so they're kind of thinking, well, maybe that was the guy that looked like it was strangling Patricia. Maybe that was the guy that was walking around. That was the footsteps. They never could figure out who the woman's ghost was. They didn't really find anything for that.
Sometimes in poltergeist case, it seems that because of the poltergeist focus, which is the kid, because they're in an altered state, an altered mental state, they can sometimes gain access to information they wouldn't normally know. Good example would be like Janet. Janet Hodgson from Enfield Poltergeist.
Yeah.
She knew who the prior tenant was who had died in the house and how he had died. So there's a chance that if this was classic Poltergeist, that Billy, as a young boy, may have picked up on the fact that Zyprian had existed in that area and kind of recreated an image of Zyprian. Doesn't mean the ghost of Zyprian was there. It's more right. like he's seeing the past yeah. and bringing it to life. Using psychic abilities. We're going to call them psychic abilities. I don't really believe they're psychic abilities per se. I think it's really more of a glitch in physics. It has something to do with quantum physics.
Well, interestingly, I found another account of the case. It was like on an evangelical blog, and it was called The Haunted Beans.
Yeah.
And she mentioned a few things that weren't really mentioned on the show. One of the things she mentioned was that at first they assumed that the ghost was just one ghost and they had a nickname for it. They called it Henry.
Yeah.
So I'm assuming that this is the one that they attributed the footsteps and everything like that to. She also pointed out that the incident in 1971 or 1972 where the older sister Patty said she felt like something touched her leg. They said it actually grabbed her leg like hard enough to leave a bruise or a red mark. Also, there is some stuff about Billy saying that he saw a ring of fire coming down through the ceiling and he saw a woman that looked like an angel or that he perceived as an angel. This was apparently in his book. Also, he says that he became kind of a pyromaniac later, which they didn't really get into on the show. So he evidently had started some fires in the house and one of them, like his brother almost died.
This sounds like the classic Poltergeist.
Yeah.
If you ask me.
Basically, they're going through the things like the Poltergeist activity, you know, the faucets coming on, lights turning on and off, which they didn't really mention on the show. Doors opening and closing by themselves. Glass storm door exploded from the inside out. They didn't show that on the show.
Right.
And apparently none of their relatives would stay there because everybody knew the house was haunted. So at some stage, it seems that they established that they thought that there were four entities in the house.
Yeah, bullshit.
Yeah. So I'm just saying.
Right.
And here's the funny part. Oh, well, okay. They didn't show this on the show either, even though this might have been kind of a cool visual. This says late in the decade, so I guess 1978, 1979... The whole family was horrified by a portrait of Patty, who was the daughter, that had always hung on the wall. One day, the picture actually deformed, making Patty look evil.
Okay. Which, what happened to the picture?
I don't know. It didn't say.
Okay.
But I'm interested that they didn't put that on the show, because that would have been really cool.
Right.
That would have been a really cool visual, even if it didn't really happen.
Right.
Now, the next thing that it says on this blog, in July 1977, the family saw, guess what? A UFO.
Oh,
in
shit.
The vicinity. Okay. So, yeah. So, now they're trying to link
it all together.
The UFOs with, yeah. So
that's
then,
a common thing that you see on little 2-bit podcasts.
So evidently, then it kind of goes on to say that Billy actually got the idea. Well, not the idea, but he actually started going in a more religious type direction from his Uncle Cliff.
Right.
And so he kind of went off in that sort of spiritual warrior kind of direction. Like I said, from his website, he had this is how the list goes. He's an exorcist.
Yeah.
A deliverance minister,
okay.
A life coach, an author, a spiritual warfare expert,
okay, all right,
a media personality, okay,
okay,
and an inspirational speaker.
All right.
And he's been on a bunch of stuff. Like I said, he was on a bunch of other episodes of Haunting, even though I couldn't find which ones they were. He's been on the Sci-Fi Channel, the Travel Channel, Destination America, Animal Planet, Beyond Belief. There was a show on the Lifetime Movie Network called I Was Possessed.
Okay.
Evidently, he was on that. Now, he supposedly goes around helping other people that have had similar experiences.
Yeah.
So, do you have anything you would like to add on this particular case, Billy Bean, House of the Dead, Season 2, Episode 5 of A Haunting?
Okay. Well, if this happened, which it sounds like to me that it did happen, if it happened, it's classic Poltergeist. The reason is always RSPK, recurrent spontaneous psychokinesis. You got a young kid in a lot of turmoil inside of a bad family. He's keeping it bottled up. And by some unknown means, he has, I guess, what you would call a psychic temper tantrum. This causes objects to move, causes sounds to be produced, ghostly sounds, apparitions. It makes a bunch of disturbances. What he's describing kind of fits that. It's not all that uncommon.
It does kind of sound like that. Other than it going on for such a long time.
Yeah, there may be exaggerations in the case. There could be a bunch of stuff that was added to the case, too.
Yeah. And I should note that I have not read the book,
right.
Dark Force.
Yeah, reading the book would probably know more about it.
Yeah.
Because...
So there might have been a lot of stuff that he went into in the book that wasn't on the show.
Right. It loosely fits a phenomenon known as poltergeist. That's all I can say about it.
Yeah.
If the testimony that was presented through a haunting is accurate, I'm going to say that this is poltergeist, kind of like my case.
A lot of the things that they described seem very similar to what you described.
And it sounds like there's a little bit of embellishment involved in certain areas. I think what it was is he couldn't find an explanation for himself, so he pushed it into the religious realm, maybe with the intent of marketing it some way.
Yeah, because it does seem like he didn't really get into the religious angle until later on.
No, when I talked to him, basically everything was read the book, buy my book.
No, I mean, later on.
Yeah, it was like, after.
Yeah, that came about after. That was, it was almost like a retcon of what he thought had happened. He, you know, like later on, he was attributing it to. I don't think he ever said it was demons.
Right.
But he said that it was four different entities that were causing various behavioral things and causing him to, like I said, become a pyromaniac, his dad to become an alcoholic or whatever. So it was kind of like possession that he was describing, even though he didn't use that word on the show.
If any of our regular listeners have read this book, I'd like to hear from you.
Because I'm sure there's, like I said, I'm sure there's a lot of details in there.
And our regulars, especially our subscribers, they know how I think. They've studied the same stuff that I've studied, so you know what I mean? They'll know if it's the real thing or not.
And I just want to mention, apropos of nothing, but when we were rewatching this episode, I don't know if this was a set that they used or if it was an actual house that they used to film this in. You know, because it's supposed to be taking place in 1970. The wallpaper in these rooms was like so horrifying that it was cool again.
That you liked it.
That it was badass. Mm-hmm. Like, I'm looking at that going, that is so ugly that it's fucking beautiful. I would totally, especially the one room where the daughter was sleeping.
Yeah, yeah.
Stripes, it was just, yeah, it was like these weird stripes of wallpaper and then there was like lime green and it was like orange. Yeah. And I'm like, God, that's hideous. Yeah. And yet quite awesome.
Well, I think they were trying to, emulate 1970s wallpaper.
Yeah.
But 70s wallpaper didn't look like that.
Well, I don't remember ever living in a house with wallpaper. All our, the houses we lived in the 70s all had that ugly faux paneling.
Yeah. Yeah, true.
I did remember like a lot of the dishes and shit that they had because I was like, oh, that looks familiar. And the fondue pot, even though she had a green one, we had an orange one.
Fondue pots belong on top of the refrigerator.
Well, that's where ours
every
always was.
Every one of them
keys in it. We never used it for its intended purpose.
Every one of them that I've ever seen was nothing more than a dust catcher.
It pretty
one
much
old
is.
Lady
well,
gives
you
it to
get
another
it as a
lady.
As a gift for like your wedding or some shit.
Yeah.
And then
one
you
old
never
lady
use
gives
it
to another old lady.
Yeah.
And they never use it.
All right, anyway. So we've gone on and on long enough about this particular episode of Haunting. Hope you guys enjoyed it. And remember, if you like the show, remember to like, share, subscribe, and share with all your friends. Tell all your friends about us. Also, if you'd like to financially support the show, check out our Patreon page at patreon.com/13o'clock or go to our blog, which is 13o'clockpodcast.wordpress.com. And there's a link in the sidebar to a PayPal account where you can give a one-time donation if you would like to do that. Also, check out our Zazzle store at zazzle.com/13o'clock. We have several different designs of t-shirts and a tote bag that you may purchase if you wish. And that will do it for our latest episode, episode 94. We will see you next time. Bye. The great